మీరు ఓకే ఓకే సార్ అలాగే రండి. ఆ లింక్ తో జాయిన్ అవ్వండి సార్. అయితే లింక్ మీకు అలాగే సార్ ఓకే పంపిస్తాను సార్.
అది వస్తుంది. ఓకే ఓకే ఓకే
సార్, వెరీ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్, డాక్టర్ కె శ్రీనివాస్ సార్, అండ్ ఆల్సో వెరీ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ టు ఆల్ పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ ఆఫ్ టుడే. దట్ ఈస్ ద సెకండ్ డే ఆఫ్ ఎఫ్టిపి ప్రోగ్రామ్ ఆన్ ఎన్విరాన్మెంటల్ పొల్యూషన్ సస్టైనబుల్ టెక్నాలజీస్ ఫర్ ఇట్స్ కంట్రోల్. టుడే స్పీకర్ ఈస్ డాక్టర్ కె శ్రీనివాస్. ఐ నౌ రిక్వెస్ట్ డాక్టర్ వి దిల్లేశ్వర్ రావు టు ఇంట్రొడ్యూస్ టుడే స్పీకర్ డాక్టర్ కె శ్రీనివాస్, వైస్ ప్రెసిడెంట్ అండ్ హెడ్ టెక్నికల్ అండ్ రీసెర్చ్ రామ్కి ఎన్విరో ఇంజనీరింగ్ లిమిటెడ్ హైదరాబాద్, హూ విల్ బి స్పీకింగ్ ఆన్ హజార్డస్ వేస్ట్ హ్యాండ్లింగ్ అండ్ మేనేజ్మెంట్. నో ఓవర్ టు దిల్లేశ్వర.
థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్. A very good morning to respected dignitaries and my dear participants. It's my immense pleasure to introduce an eminent personality who born for waste management to reduce the environmental pollution, and he is none other than Dr. K. Srinivas Garu, who always believes that recycling turns things into other things, which is like magic. Dr. K. Srinivas Garu strongly believes that environment is painting for us day after day pictures of infinite beauty. And Dr. Srinivas Rao Garu done his MSc in Environmental Chemistry and awarded a distinction from Andhra University, Visakhapatnam. Dr. K. Srinivas Rao Garu also done his PhD from Andhra University. Currently, he is acting as a Vice President, Head of Technical and Research for Ramki Environment Engineers Limited, Hyderabad. Formerly, he worked in various government organizations and corporate companies like Visakhapatnam Port Trust, Tata Steel, SGS Western Solutions, etc. He was project head for the first engineered landfill of the country developed by Ramki at Hyderabad. He is the member expert advisory committee for water management technology in the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He is associated in industry academy collaborative research with various institutes like IITM, IICT, BITS Hyderabad, etc. He also a well-known speaker and external faculty for various institutes like IITs, NITs, universities, etc. for capacity building skill development programs on environment management. He has published more research papers in well-reputed journals on environment and waste management. He has 30 years of experience in this field of waste management. All we know that if you look after the land, and the land will look after you. If you destroy the land, and it will destroy you. So we should know how the waste management was done. With these few words, I request Dr. K. Srinivas Rao Garu to take over the session and enlighten us on the wastewater management. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to introduce a versatile personality.
Okay, thank you, Dillesa Rao. Now I request Dr. K. Srinivas to give the presentation of his talk.
At the outset, thank you very much, Kotesh Rao Garu and Dillesh Rao Garu, for elaborative introduction. Thank you very much. And I really thankful to Kotesh Rao Garu for lot of coordination in this and organizing and arranging this program. I'm very happy to share whatever the experience and whatever the knowledge that gained during this 3 decades of work in this area of waste management and environment solutions. So it is very happy through Dr. Gournaid Garu, he is our senior. I am able to reach to your very important and very prestigious college, and I'm very happy to address at this time. Thank you very much, sir. So now I will share one presentation. Before that, because this is for the students or faculty, sir?
Faculty.
Faculty.
Okay. Let us see what is this waste management or solid waste management. So if we see the waste means we have different kinds of waste. The waste that is generated from industries is hazardous waste. So it is having different properties of toxicity, toxic waste or corrosive waste kind of things. Suppose there is a waste that generates from the households, that is the domestic waste, that is municipal solid waste. And there is a waste that is generated from hospitals, that we call it as biomedical waste. Similarly, there is a waste like electronic waste, there is a plastic waste, there is a, we have so many different types of solid waste. Even the vehicles, whatever the vehicles that we are using, after some time, like 15 years, they will be like end of life vehicles. They will also become waste. So everything, if we don't use them properly, if we don't handle them properly, if we don't manage them properly, there is a possibility, there is a problem that it may cause damage to the environment. So especially if we talk on the hazardous waste, the hazardous waste is, the name itself is saying that it is hazardous to the nature. If we don't handle it, don't manage it properly, then it causes problem to the environment. I will just share my presentation just for easy understanding.
Sir, we are able to see the screen.
Okay. Okay. Are you able to see the screen, sir?
Yes, sir. Now it is fine, sir.
Right. Full screen. So, what is hazardous waste? Hazardous waste is any waste, please just, I am reading this, please be, just follow this. Any waste which by reason of characteristics, that means the properties, such as physical, chemical, biological. So the physical properties or the chemical properties or the biological properties of any waste, which are reactive, toxic, flammable, explosive or corrosive, these kind of properties, if we find in a waste and if it causes danger or likely to cause danger to health or environment, whether alone or in contact with other waste or substances, that is what is called hazardous waste. Actually, there is a term called other waste. This other waste is mostly something like a waste fit for recycling. So that is also has been added in recent rules in the legislation 2016 hazardous waste handling and management rules. So the waste is the materials that are not products or byproducts for which the generator has no further use for the purpose of production or transformation or consumption. So this generally, see, it is neither product or nor byproduct, then it is a waste. The manufacturer intends to dispose of, send it out. So then what are the options for this? See, if the waste is not handled properly, then this waste will cause irreparable damage or incapacitative illness to the people. So this waste has to be properly handled. What are the options? We have recycling, reuse, recovery of these waste is possible. And for that, we have co-processing, pre-processing, or the utilization. These are all the terminologies. These are all the options that have been brought into the new hazardous waste management rules. So like it starts, the thinking or the concept is like prevention of waste, minimization of waste, reuse of waste, recycling, recovery. Recovery is by recovery of energy, recovery of the material. That I will explain you a little later. And if not everything, then try to dispose in a safe manner. So this is actually what is the initial understanding what is hazardous waste. Now let us see how to identify and characterize the waste. See, identification and characterization of waste. See, there is a waste. We are saying that it is hazardous in nature. So how do we identify? See, there are actually there are six schedules. Schedule 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six schedules are there in rules, hazardous waste management rules. The first schedule is based on industrial process. If there is an industrial process, there are some, I will let you know, 38 industrial processes are there. These industrial processes, specific process like exploration of oil, oil exploration like ONGC, GAIL, Reliance, all these people, they will explore the gas and oil. In the process, they will get some waste. So that is, there are like the drill cutting mud, the cuttings and all, they are all hazardous. Like that, manufacture of the medicines, pharma. So in the process, they generate some steel bottom residues, the ETP sludge, all that. Like 38 kind of different processes are there. Each process has a definite outcome of waste. So they are all defined in that. The second schedule says that based on waste constituents with concentration limits. So there are like in schedule 2, we have to analyze the waste. What is the waste? What is the concentration? Suppose there is a chromium in the waste, like lead in the waste, cadmium in the waste, mercury in the waste. So these are the different kinds of the concentration of elements, the chemicals, toxic constituents. We have to estimate, and based on the character, the concentration limits, we will say whether it is hazardous or not. Then the other things are import, export, recycling, all they are there. Let us try to understand little bit more on in the schedule 1, we have like 38 industrial processes, 127 types of waste are there, and out of which there are some waste, very huge volume, fly ash. The fly ash is generated from these thermal power plants and several boilers and all. This fly ash has not been included as a hazardous waste. And it is having a little impact, but volume is very high. So they have a separate utilization and separate guidelines. Same way, the phosphor gypsum, red mud. This red mud is in very huge quantities generated from aluminum industry. Jarosite, this is from zinc and lead industry. Slag, pyrometallurgical operations, mine tilings. See, mine tilings are those when we do the extraction of the ore, mining operations, we get a lot of the ore burden and other waste while ore washing operations and all. A lot of waste in very huge quantities. millions, thousands of millions of tons of waste comes over beneficiation. So these are all the processes. So they are not put it under hazardous waste category. So, but they have a different way of approach and handling of those things. See, in the Schedule 2, we are saying that it is based on the concentration limits. So there is one term called leachable concentration. Leachable concentration is like, see, there is a waste, and waste, if you put water in that, or some acid or base or whatever, if it is it is mixed with water, it will, the components, the constituents, the chemicals that are there in that material, they will leach out, they will come out because of this solubility. So they will get solubilized and they will come out. Even not solubilized, with the water, the kind of the separation from the solid, they will be taken out, extracted out, leached out from this material. So that leachable concentration, how much is that is leaching into the solution, is what is important. So that is what is called a procedure called toxicity characteristic leaching procedure. What we do, we take waste, we put water in that, and we try to rotate it for 24 hours a day, and then after that we filter it and test the leachate. Then that leachate is tested for various components, various constituents like arsenic, barium, cadmium, lead, manganese, mercury, selenium, silver, ammonia. These are all very, very, what I want to tell, they are toxic, more toxic. If you see, the concentration limits are very, very, very low. 5 milligrams per liter. If it contains 5 milligrams per liter, 5 ppm, then it is toxic. Barium is 100 ppm is toxic. Cadmium, 1 ppm is toxic. Mercury, you see, 0.2 ppm is toxic. If it is chromium, this is actually total chromium. But hexavalent chromium is highly dangerous. Hexavalent chromium is more toxic than the chromium, trivalent chromium or chromium 3. See, now you have several other things. Cyanide is there, nitrate, sulfide, all these things we will understand, identify the concentration in the water, leachate, and then see benzene having 0.5 ppm is dangerous. And benzoyapyrene, this is what is called the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbon, this is PAH. This is actually cancer causing, even benzene is a cancer causing carcinogenic compound. These compounds, if we leach out, the leachate concentration contains 0.001 ppm. That means 1 ppb, 1 microgram per liter. Then it is dangerous. Then it is hazardous. That substance, we have to handle it very carefully. We have to dispose of, we have to do whatever the best possible methods. See, you see several things are added. Bromo, dichloromethane, bromoform. These are all halogen compounds. And then naphthalene, nitrobenzene. So these are all identified in the, given in the hazardous waste management rules. Aurochlore, actually, this is a little spelling mistake. Aurochlore, these are all called PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls, PCBs. They are again very, very dangerous to the environment. You see several other things, atrazine, endosulfan, endrin, these are all pesticides. Chlorodyne, these are all pesticides. Linden is a herbicide. Malathion. So all these are all identified, and the concentrations, DDT, DDE, aldrin, even fluoride is there. In the, that leachate, what are, if the fluoride concentration is 180 ppm, then that is, see the dioxin. Dioxins and furans are highly dangerous, in the atmosphere emissions. They are in nanograms, 0.1 nanogram per milligram per meter cube is dangerous. 0.1 nanogram, not microgram. 0.1 nanogram per meter cube of air. If these dioxins and furans are there, then that is more than that is dangerous. So these things, how to test it, what is to be done, all the test methods, everything, they are all given in the rules. There are USCPA test methods are there for TCLP, and the other test methods are also there for, this is actually how to test and all given. Now, in the class B, the first one is class A, then class B is actually the direct, not the leachate. Direct solid is tested, this is total threshold limit concentration, like asbestos, 10,000 milligram. This is actually milligram per kg. This is milligram per kg. If we take solid, this is direct solid actually. One kg of solid if we take, then if it is having 10,000 milligrams, then it is hazardous. Asbestos is directly that filaments, they're all hazardous. Same way, the petroleum hydrocarbons, there that is 5,000 ppm. So now, there are in class C, there are different properties have been defined in order to know the waste is hazardous or not. In class C, these are all I am talking on hazardous waste management rules. See here, we have some properties. If the waste is a flammable waste, flammable liquids, flammable solids, oxidizer, compressed gas, all these things are all hazardous. They are all hazardous waste. See, suppose like any solvents in a pharma industry, they use a lot of solvents, mother liquors, for extraction. After several repeated extractions, the spent solvent will be not useful. That will become very viscous and they will throw it out. That solvent is a liquid, but it is flammable in nature. So they are all having anything having flash point less than 60 degrees centigrade, flammable vapor having a flash point less than 60 degrees centigrade is hazardous, is actually flammable. And if it is, even though it is not a liquid, but causing fire through friction, absorption, even solids are also supposed to exhibit these kind of properties. There are the compressed gases, even aerosol cans, which will have the compressed gas, oxidizers. These are all like, they come under this category C1 flammable. And C2 is a different waste category, where the wastes are corrosive in nature. That means any waste having pH less than 2 or greater than 12.5, actually these numbers have been changed recently. This is less than 4 or greater than, this is less than 4 or greater than 11 have been taken in the 2016 rules. They are a little bit changed. So they are called, that means highly acidic waste or highly basic waste, they are called the hazardous waste. So it is a liquid and corrodes. If it is a liquid and if it corrodes, then that is hazardous waste. How to test, how to say it is corrosion, how to say it is the pH. Earlier, the flammability is based on the flash point, 60 degrees centigrade less than 50, then it is flammable. pH, if it is less than 2 or more than 12.5, or we can take 4 or 11, whatever no issues. So pH is a measurement for corrosion testing. And then the other property is reactive waste or explosive waste. If the waste is reactive, that means if it gets in contact with water, it absorbs moisture in the atmosphere, then it starts reacting. It will react violently and it may get oxidized. It may readily capable of detonation. So certain things are all called reactive waste. Some are water reactive, some are reaction with the air. Even if you just open, that will, it may catch fire. See, what will happen, certain things, no, they will react with moisture in the atmosphere and liberate hydrogen. When the hydrogen is liberated, and if there is any kind of ignition source, it immediately burns. The whole thing will burn. So, and sometimes, you know, they will get even sodium. You just open the sodium and it will, any moisture, water, then it will explode even. So, these are all like different substances. They are highly reactive substances. Thionyl chloride, aluminum chloride, the free magnesium, free zirconium. These are all, they will generate hydrogen, very highly oxidizing compounds, highly reductive, reducing compounds. And then we have like something like cyanide and sulfide. Suppose the waste is having reactive cyanide. What will happen? Hydrogen cyanide gas will come. Hydrogen sulfide will come. They have all these things are quite possible in the waste having cyanide is quite common, because many industries, they will use the plating operations, or jewelry people, they all use cyanide as one of the reagents, and at the end of the day they will just throw the waste, cyanide waste or sulfide waste. So that will come. Some people, they may not tell that they are using it. Then what will happen in the waste? No, if there is any acid, see, I get one truckload of cyanide waste, I'll put it in somewhere, and if there is anything, some other acid waste, what will happen? Acid and cyanide, you will get hydrogen cyanide, HCN gas, and the people around will automatically, I'll tell you, die. It is fatal. Hydrogen sulfide in excess concentrations, it is dangerous. More than 500 ppm of hydrogen sulfide is dangerous. More than 200 ppm of cyanide, reactive cyanide, is dangerous. So we have to be extremely careful. When any truck comes, we have to test this reaction. Whether is the waste is having any cyanide or sulfide, every consignment, every batch has to be tested. Otherwise, it's going to be a disaster. Same way, any oxidizing, reducing, let's say highly acidic, highly basic, because high acid and base, if they mix, there is a thermal heat of neutralization will happen. A lot of heat will generate, and sometimes you have a potential to catch fire. Then the another category is toxic category. Toxic category is lethal to the aquatic life, or that's based on the fish mortality and all. This test is done. But normally we have a different test, as I told you, the TCLP test. Normally we are not following this LD50. This is a theoretical methodology, but we follow toxicity characteristic leaching procedure. That test, based on that, we have the formulas. But this way also we can test, but they will have long duration testing. So normally we do, for the toxicity, we do TCLP test to know the waste carcinogenicity, cancer causing, mutagenicity, causing mutations, endocrine disruptivity, whatever the endocrine system that is there that gets disrupted. Acute toxicity, chronic toxicity, bioaccumulative properties. You know, bioaccumulation is like, no, we all know that Minamata disease, that mercury, accumulation of mercury in the fish by in the Japan, Minamata Bay, that all that story we know. Same way, anything that will go on get accumulated in something else, and then that if we consume that material, it may be plant or it may be animal. So that is what is called bioaccumulation. So this is on toxic properties. In addition to, these are the four properties: corrosive, reactive, ignitable, toxic. This is what is called CRIT, CRIT criteria. So if any waste exhibiting these properties, four properties principally, there, these things we call them as hazardous waste. In addition to that, we have certain other properties also. Substances or waste liable to spontaneous combustion. So the this all actually this can go into reactive kind of a thing. Substances or waste which in contact with water emit flammable gas, same thing. So flammable gas will come, that is hydrogen kind of thing. This is also, I will take it into reactive waste. Oxidizing, again reactive waste. Organic peroxides, poisonous substances, that is cyanide, we are talking of poison. So these are all different categories, numbers are given in the rules. But we principally, we can put all of them into the reactive things. Infectious substances, like, no, see these biotechnical, the vaccines, the companies who develop vaccines and all, they use a lot of the microorganisms and the broth, the petri dishes, whatever the they take out, all that if they throw it, no, any viable microorganisms and all, if they are thrown into the atmosphere, they cause diseases and they are all infectious, dangerous, lethal and pathogenic. The organisms will be there in that. Liberation of toxic gases in contact with air or water. See, if normally the waste may not be toxic, but if it in contacts with air or water, then it gets reacted and it may react any kind of gases. Then they are also treated as hazardous waste. Ecotoxic, just let us read what is the meaning of this. Substances or waste which if released may present immediate or delayed adverse impacts to the environment by means of bioaccumulation or toxic effects upon biotic systems or both. So anything that is causing damage to the ecology, ecosystem, environment per se, we can say that those substances are ecotoxic substances. And the last one is capable of yielding another material. See, by means of or after disposal, yielding another material, that is leachate. So that leachate, if it is dangerous, is having more all these properties, then we will say that that material is hazardous. It's a solid, but if there is a rain, if it is exposed to rain, and the leachate is exhibiting these properties, then that is hazardous substance. So now what is the solution? Now we understand there is a material, there is a waste that is hazardous. Then how to handle it? What is the solution? So this waste has to be treated properly. This waste has to be stored till it is treated or disposed. So there should be a proper storage. And then we should think of how we can we reuse, can we recover anything, can we recycle this waste. If we should try and prioritize these things as a best option rather than disposal. Disposal is actually the disposal is, there is a two ways of either bury or burn. So either by landfilling or by incineration, burning. So these are the two safe disposal methods. For that, if you see in a treatment, storage, disposal operation of any hazardous area, first what we have to do, we have to do a comprehensive analysis of the waste, because we need to know what is the waste. There is a waste, we need to know what does it contains. So we have to do a detailed testing. After that, we have a waste acceptance criteria. Suppose this is having cadmium 10 ppm, chromium 5 ppm, mercury 0.1 ppm. So based on all this report, based on that, there is a limits. So if it is less than 0.2 ppm, that mercury can be disposed into landfill. Suppose the chromium content is less than 0.5 ppm, then you can put it into landfill. Otherwise, it is not fit for even secured landfill. So that is why there is a criteria by the Ministry of Environment, Forests for disposal of hazardous waste. Then we know how to dispose of. Okay, is it fit for landfill? Is it fit for incineration? Is it that can be recycled? What are all the things? We will come to a decision. Then the waste will be transported from the industry or from anywhere that is, it is generated to the site disposal facility. There is a manifest system. So we have to, there are some forms we have to have. Otherwise, during transportation, illegal disposal dumping can be restricted, avoid, can be controlled only because of these apps. So this, this nowadays, it is, it has become online. So we need to have a permit to carry, transport the waste on the road. So then once it comes to the facility, it will be weighed and recorded, the weight. Then it will be started, tracked inside the facility how the waste is moving. A sample is collected from the truck. I told you the truck may contain some waste. So initially we have done testing on a sample. Here you got the waste truck load. So this truck load, we have to take another sample, quick sample, do a fingerprint analysis. Fingerprint analysis is an analysis to check whether the sample what we received and the waste that he received here at the site, both are same. If required, we have to put the waste in a temporary storage for analysis, during analysis and all. Then based on this analysis, okay, yes, this waste will go, this can be reused, this can be recovered, this can be recycled. If not, either you do to bury or burning, either by landfilling or by incineration, or there may be a pre-treatment required before landfill, pre-treatment required before incineration. That also we need to know, we need to undertake, then we have to do accordingly. So I want to know any whether am I audible? Are you anything you want to talk on this so far?
Audible, sir.
Okay. So is it clear now what I am saying? See, the waste, we have waste, hazardous waste, and this hazardous waste, first of all, we are trying to understand whether the waste is hazardous or not. For that, we have a methodology like corrosive, reactive, ignitable, toxic. So with these definite testing procedures, we try to do how to test, and let us see how to handle. Now in a laboratory, how we do test and what are the various testing parameters that we do in a comprehensive analysis. So there are physical analysis. So when we see the truck, we open the cover, then we'll see whether is it a liquid, slurry, sludge, semi-solid, it is it in drums or bulk or bags. So then we have to see that. Then is it in one layer, two layers, different colors, color, texture. all that specific gravity, viscosity, calorific value, all these things we have to test. Then we have to do the flash point, because 60 degrees centigrade is our limit. Calorific value is 2500. If it is more than 2500 kilocalories per kg, then it will ignite, then it will burn. It is capable of burning. So then we have to incinerate it. We should not put it in the landfill. Same way, what is when we dry at 105 degrees centigrade, what is how much is the percent loss? Loss on drying, loss on ignition at 550 degrees. That means volatiles. What is the how much organic content it is having? We will come to know. Then there is one specific test called paint filter liquid test. This test will tell us whether there are any free liquids in the waste. And like that, we'll do cyanide react to cyanide, sulfide, inorganics, organics, CHNS, percent carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, hydrogen, sulfur, all that we do test. And then we do organics. As I told you, we do TCLP test for the toxic parameters. What are all various several equipment that we use to test all these things is a gas chromatograph, GCMS, GCFID, ECD, atomic absorption, ICP spectrometer, CHNS, bomb calorimeter, etc., etc. This is an ICP, ICP OES, optical emission spectrometer. And then this is a GCMS, where we have, this is a GC and this is a mass detector, with auto sampler and all. And then this is a bomb calorimeter for testing of calorific value. Like that, we do all the testing done. And then the waste will be collected from the industry to the disposal site, truly following motor vehicle rules and the Central Pollution Control Board guidelines, hazardous waste rules. A lot of the drivers should be 10th qualified. The truck should be a specific color coded, blue with a white strap. All these things are there. I told you manifest system. All these things, there should be an emergency card in case there is an accident, something, anything happened. Then that card, there will be a card. That card will give all the details of the waste. What is the type of waste? What are the properties? What are everything will be there in that card, and to whom to contact, all phone numbers, everything will be there. So in the truck, you know, on the containers, all four sides with a fluorescent label will be there. With all the details about the waste. The truck should have hazardous waste carrier. That name should be there. And then these are all the various say, copies of manifest. I am not detailing this. Six copies will have one with the customer, that is the generator, who generates the waste. And then one with the operator, who actually handles the waste. And then who transport the waste. Generator, transporter, operator, and regulator. Regulator is the pollution control board. Between these four people, this manifest system will be the documentation will be done between these four. So how to all the rules and all, they're all definite guidelines for transportation, definite guidelines for handling and management of waste within the facility. When the trucks comes inside, that will be weighed on a weigh bridge. Then this is the kind of color, blue color with a white strip. That means this is hazardous vehicle. Any container, anything you see on the road, this means that is carrying hazardous waste. There you can see their name also. So then that truck, the sample has to be taken. And then the waste will go in a temporary storage facility if for testing or before it is actually disposed of. So as I told you, when we take the sample from the container or the truck, we have to do a quick analysis, because we need to know whether what sample we have tested and what waste we got are same or not. Otherwise, again, no, the cyanide or sulfide, initially if it is not there, but now it is there, then it is dangerous. We need to know. That is why we have to keep the truck in a temporary shed till we do all the analysis. Then only we can this kind of fingerprint analysis we do. Then these are all the criteria. I told you pH should be, sorry, 4 to 12, less than 4 or more than 12, if it is there, then it is cannot go to directly into landfill. Phenols, arsenic, less than 1 ppm, lead, less than 2 ppm, cadmium, less than 0.2 ppm, chromium 6, hexavalent chromium 0.5, mercury 0.1. Like this, we have all set of parameters. Then the disposal pathway we discussed. So what we do, if we the waste has to go to landfill, then a landfill has to be prepared like this, secured landfill with all the liners. This is the bottom clay lining, and on top of that there is a HDPE plastic lining, and then there is a drainage media with all the pipeline network and all leachate collection network. This is how two layers of this is all placed, and now this kind of a landfill is will be made. This is called secured landfill. This is one from the bottom, one from the top to remove the leachate. So this landfill is a safe landfill for disposal of waste like this. So there will be no contamination to the ground or groundwater or land. So the trucks will be automatically dispose of waste in the landfill. And then a lot of compaction and all care is taken for during monsoon when there is a rains. The waste should not get mixed with water. So we have to completely cover and see that there is no leachate or any wastewater that is generated. And every year, whatever the completed portion, we have to cap it. This portion is capped. This portion is under capping. This is operations. And the next cell is actually under construction. Like that, every time we have different cells, different operations like this. Something is capped, something is under capping, and even in capping also, we have to put final soil cover, green cover, plants, everything we have to do. So the trucks will be, the tires will be washed in the water before they go out. Same way, whatever the leachate that is generated from the landfill, that should be properly handled, and that should be treated in a leachate treatment facility. Waste, if sometimes the waste, if it is not fit for directly landfill, then we need to treat it. Then we need to stabilize the waste to bring it down its toxicity before it is disposed of into the landfill. And then the incineration is actually burning of waste. While burning, even whatever the kind of waste that we burn, it may be cyanide we are burning, if it is a mercury we are burning, if it is a polychlorinated bisphenyls, which may generate dioxin, furans from the stack. Even then, we have to have a system. Actually, this and this up to here only burning. Up to here, these two is a burning from here to here. From here, from this big one till this, this is all the pollution control system. Air pollution control system. So this incinerator is a very foolproof system where we have a dual combustion chamber. There is a big rotary kiln here. It's not seen in this picture. So rotary kiln, there is a secondary combustion chamber. There is a spray dryer here. There are different cyclone. These are all cyclones, multi-cyclone separators. There are all the neutralizing reagents, chemical treatment systems here to neutralize the acidic gases. And then we have the back filters for removal of dust. And there are scrubbers for complete removal of dust or the any kind of acidic things. And finally, this will be let out into the environment. Duly, a safe treated gas will be removed out. Let into the environment. So these are all the concentration limits. See, you can see here the concentration of mercury or some other metals into the atmosphere, the concentration 0.05 milligrams per normal meter cube. Whereas, as I told you, the dioxins and furan concentration 0.1 nanogram per normal meter cube. So this is really so even that very small concentration in the atmosphere will pose problem to the people and environment. So we have to be careful in burning the waste. So then while these operations, a lot of environment protection, safety, health, the people working is very important, because we are handling the hazardous waste. A lot of personal protective equipment we require, like the gloves, masks, the respirators, goggles, helmets, etc. And all the storage sheds and all, we have to have firefighting systems, and there is a smoke detectors, alarms, etc., etc. They are all required, because we do handle a lot of waste that is a highly potential corrosive, potential ignitable or reactive waste. Then there is a very danger. So, and also the people working in these kind of waste management facilities, they have to be tested for their health time to time to see that there is no occupational health issues. Similarly, we have to focus on the environment and green belt around the sites. We have to have beautiful the aesthetic development, also very important. This is the site actually, Hyderabad, in this facility. Right now also I am giving this presentation from this site. This site was developed by me. This was the first facility in the country. This actually, all these plants, this is an illegal contaminated site. It's a dump site. Before 2000, all the industrial waste was dumped here, and because of the founder of this Ramki Enviro Engineers Limited, Mr. Ayoj Ramireddy, he was instrumental in developing the first facility in the country for the Ramki. I am very fortunate. I joined from Environment Protection Training Research Institute. I left that and joined Ramki. Developed with the support and guidance from Australian government and Australian experts, we developed the secured landfills and incinerator facilities. All these plants were brought from Rajahmundry Kadiyam area, because I born from East Godavari. I know those people and all. I have a lot of interest in these plants also. So this is all the passion. Anybody know? We all, unless we have passion, we can't do anything. That is what I used to talk, and I used to tell all my people. We, whatever that work that we do, we have to really, we have to work, we have to enjoy it, and we should treat that it is as a like very prestigious and very important and significant. Okay, then so I think that's it. That's all what I want to present. Then I want to understand from the people, like I can keep it. I want to listen. Anybody wants to say anything, any more clarification? Response.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for all the presentation on different hazardous waste materials, different types of waste like solid, liquid, and handling of waste materials, and a comprehensive analysis, and explain in a detail on hazardous waste management rules and etc. So thank you very much, sir. Very valuable presentations. Now we are moving to question and answer sessions.
Yeah.
Sir, thank you, sir, for the wonderful talk. I am Koteshwar Rao. Sir,
thank you, sir.
There are one or two questions on your talk.
Please.
Yes, sir. Rashmi Mahapatra, the question is, what is the way forward for holistically disposing e-waste in a sustainable manner?
Yes, sir. E-waste is also a type of hazardous waste, but e-waste is actually a separate rules are there for e-waste. E-waste is mainly That is like no computers, the laptops, computers, mobiles, yes, and then the all electronic and electrical equipments. Yes. So these are all having some toxic elements, some precious metals. See, we have a lot of precious metals in this e-waste. So yes, like sir. Gold, platinum, palladium, rhodium, the silver. These are all the different types of precious metals we see. Copper. So these, so we have to recover all of them. See, e-waste, 99% of e-waste is recyclable, recoverable. Yeah. Only 1%, some kind of hazardous things will come that we have to handle. See, there is a TV screen. There is a cathode ray CRT. Yeah. In that, there are fire retardants like polybrominated compounds and all. We have to suck it, take it out, and there are some kind of a lead in the batteries. There is some mercury switches, mercury. So these are all small amount of hazardous things we have to separate out. All other things is all recyclable. Actually, I am glad to inform you that we are setting up one refinery in this place from where the first plant in the country, I told you, here we are setting up one refinery for recovery of platinum, palladium, gold, silver, copper. All these things are going to be recovered. I think you can see this, you can hear. I think maximum 5 to 6 months this will get commissioned. This is the initial stages. We got the permission to do that. So in Hyderabad, the biggest refinery is going to come up.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I think that will be a profitable business as well for industry or anybody.
So number one, profitable. It's a profit, more than a profit. See, anything is
environment.
Like, anything techno viable, technically and commercially, if it is not viable, that project is not going to sustain or survive. So first of all, it should be technically correct. And because of that, we don't need to export all our resources. What is happening? We are exporting to outside, to Western countries, European countries. We need not do that. Our gold, we can do here only. We can refer here.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And so from the same participant, one more question. Any latest technology available for biomedical waste that is lesson learned from COVID-19, if at all?
So, sir, the biomedical waste is actually infectious waste. This infectious waste, biomedical waste, will be disposed of either by the incineration, because the infection we don't want to. Like some cut anatomical waste, the body parts, fluids, anything infected material will be burnt.
Okay, burning
and,
only.
Yes. And some kind of material like plastic, glass, metal, that what we do, we sterilize it. At very high temperature, high pressure, sterilization is done. Very effective sterilization is done. Then that material can be recycled. Plastic can be recycled. Have recycling. Right now, currently, we are trying to recycle, recover all kind of waste. We are as much as possible. We don't want to throw the waste into the landfills, or we don't want to burn the waste that has the potential for recovery or recycle. The priority is reuse or recycle or recover.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And one more question from DJ Rao. I think Jagannath Rao, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. When do we say ETP waste is hazardous waste? I think all ETP wastes are hazardous. So when we say that that ETP waste is hazardous?
Sir, ETP waste is hazardous by two categories.
Okay.
There are certain ETP wastes have been shown in Schedule 1. Okay. Schedule 1, in the process, certain processes generate, different ETP ways, there are no need of testing. That is hazardous.
Okay.
If it is there in the schedule 1, any specific ETP waste, that is hazardous. That's it.
Okay.
But still there is a ETP waste that is not listed in the schedule 1. Then we need to test. We need to test the leachate concentration, toxicity, TCLP test. So now we have all from arsenic to all the parameters we have to test. If the concentration is more than that is hazardous. If it is less than that, it is non-hazardous.
Yes, sir.
If the ETP waste, ETP sludge having a concentration of chromium less than 5 ppm, it is not hazardous.
Okay.
It is not hazardous. If it is more than 5 ppm chromium, then it is hazardous. That's it.
Okay. Yes, sir. One more question. What is the difference between hazardous material, hazardous waste?
Yes. See, it is like if anything that is generated from a process.
Okay.
So there is a raw material and a process and the product.
Okay.
Other than product or byproduct, there is something that is waste.
Okay.
If there is a, suppose diesel. Diesel is not a hazardous waste, but it is hazardous having all properties.
Yes.
It is ignitable. That is not hazardous waste. That's a hazardous material. Hazardous substance.
Okay.
Sulfur is a hazardous substance, not material.
Okay. Okay, sir. Good. Sir, one more question. Can we reuse RO reject water from Rashmi Mahapatra? Yes.
Correct. See, RO is a system where we have the reject water will have a lot of ions, all the things that it cannot be directly disposed of. It doesn't meet the discharge standards because of very high TDS. What we can do, we have to remove we have to buy high from kind of a high TDS disposal systems. Like we have to thicken it by multiple effect evaporator or spray dryer, remove the solids and use the balanced water. That is one way. And the other things are like, this water is not directly useful for any immediate use.
Okay.
Case to case, we have to customize, see the constituents, and then only we can take a call. But if we have to dispose of, we can dispose to the marine system. Again, there are testing to be done. Or otherwise, we have to treat it by spray dryer or the multiple effect evaporator.
Oh. Any implemented case study of this reuse of RO water? The same participant is asking.
Sir, RO reject is actually, RO reject is a reuse of RO reject is some trials are still going on. But RO permeate, whatever the permeate from the RO, is actually useful for various freshwater applications. Yes.
Yes, sir. I think those are the questions, sir, from the participants. I think we can now close the session. And sir, thank you very much for readily accepting and giving a talk in this FGD program.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jagannath Rao Garu. DJ Rao Garu is my guru. Both of them are my gurus. I'm very thankful being with them, in front of them. I'm giving presentation.
Yes, sir. DJ Rao Garu, you can talk. Hello. Okay, sir. I think they are just listening. So thank you from our college management and from our own side for giving your excellent talk. And I think the participants must have benefited a lot. And hope to interactive game with you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
For all participants, we will just meet again for tomorrow's talk at 10:30. It is a talk by Dr. T.N. Sri Venkateshwara Garu. So, it is latest methods on water, drinking water purification methods. So, see you tomorrow. And participants who are hearing through YouTube link, we'll be just giving it now. So, you can submit it before 12:30 for the feedback link and attendance link. Okay, thank you.